go ahead and get started. We're going to sing Go Tell on the Mountain. Stand if you wish and join us, please. Stand if you wish and join us.
What you want, brother?
Brother, brother, brother.
Well, can't read it upside down.
We might understand better than we did.
Well, good morning, church. I am Elwood Carwell. Some of you know me, some of you don't know me, and some of you wish you didn't know me. And my wife introduced me as her redneck cowboy preacher. But I'm happy to be here. Your pastor's wife called me. I could barely understand her. She was coughing and hacking, and she said Jerry couldn't talk at all. She wanted to know if I would preach today, and I said I'd be honored to. It's been a while since I've seen some of you folks. Sadly, though, some of you haven't gotten any better looking. Well, you know, they were saying looks is not everything, but it helps. I'm going to attempt to do a little song this morning. It's been a while since I've done it. And I keep talking to my guitar, but it won't call back.
Takes a lot on the bottom.
I don't know if I've done this song or not here, but it's called Crossing Death's Valley, and it was written by a friend of mine, Ken Hamlin, in 1995, and it's to the tune of Red River Valley. I don't know about that. From this earth seen someday you'll be moving. The race of your life has been run. Then you'll stand in the presence of Jesus to meet you for the things you have done. Come and sit by my side while I tell you of a Savior whose love is so true. And he went to the old cross of Calvary, where he shed his lifeblood to save you. When you come to the end of your journey, Death's Valley you face all alone, you will know that you needed a Savior to guide you to your eternal home. Come and sit by my side while I tell you of a Savior whose love is so true. Then like the to save you. If you live your life without Jesus, and you stand at the great judgment day, you remember the word that I told you, for by then it will all be too late. everybody hear me?
Yes, sir.
Can't shake your head. I'm gonna read some scripture from John, chapter 11. Now a certain man was sick, Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary and her sister Martha. It was that Mary who anointed the Lord with fragrant oil and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore the sister sent to him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom you love is sick. When Jesus heard that, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that he was sick, he stayed 2 more days in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to his disciples, let us go to Judea again. The disciples said to him, Rabbi, lately the Jews sought to stone you. Now are you going there again? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours in the day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble, because he sees the light of this world. But if he walks in the night, he stumbles, because the light is not in him. That's all I want to read. I encourage you to read the rest of chapter 11, maybe sometime today. I've entitled this message, It's Time to Let Jesus Take Action. Now in this message, time will be mentioned about 24 or 25 times. Now you don't have to count. I'm just telling you. Most people have a problem with time and time management and making sure that everything is done. Right? You know, it's time to get up. It's time to go to bed. It's time to take a break. It's time for lunch. It's time to quit work. It's time to go to shop at Walmart. It's time to get the oil change in your car. Oh, and it's time to pick up the kids for soccer. It's time for doctor's appointments. Folks, there are only so many hours in a day. Where is the time for God? Now there are 168 hours in a week. We sleep 56 of them hours if we sleep 8 hours a night. Now that leaves 112 hours a week to do all the other things you have to do. We need to make a priority list. Jesus Christ knew the value of doing things that had to be done straight away when he decided to go back to Judea. Now, his disciples, of course, tried to tell him, you know, they tried to kill you. Why are you going to go back? And Jesus said that it'd be better to do something that needed to be done straightway, even if it meant taking some risk. Don't postpone the thing We need much prayer and much listening to God. A lot of us pray, but then we don't listen. You know, I know you women say we men have selective hearing, and it's probably true. Because I can turn my hearing aids on all the time. But when we pray, do we listen? Do we wait for God's answer? Do we? Think about that. Our time is going fast, folks. The older we get, the faster it goes. You know, we go through all different crises in time. Then we don't know what to do. We get confused. And then we're unable to make sound decisions. Such crisis often causes arguments, conflict within the family, between friends, or even in our churches. Think about that. Many of the problems that arise could have been prevented if only someone could have taken control and made decisions. And what had we done with that? You think about Martha and Mary. They needed someone to take control. They were upset because Jesus had not gotten there before Lazarus died. Jesus had a plan in mind. He gave that extra 2 days to give Lazarus time to God. So when he got there, he would be dead, and he could show who he is by raising Lazarus from the dead. But the sisters were upset. They thought, Lord, you didn't arrive in time. There are visitors here. Our friends are here to mourn with us, to try and comfort us. And they said, our brother would have not have died had you been here. Amidst all of this confusion, Jesus took control and performed a mighty act. And he'll do that for you and for me. But you know what? We don't listen. Jesus got there and he got to the tomb where Lazarus was. And there we have the shortest verse in the Bible. John 11:35. Jesus wept. Jesus was God-man. He was in our human image. But he was God. But you know, we're made in his image. It tells us that in Genesis. This Jesus wept reminds me of one of the churches I pastored. About 15, 20 minutes before the main service at 11, I would meet with all of these young people. I had 15 of them. I started encouraging them to memorize scripture. Well, the next Sunday came, all 15 were there. Guess what 5 of them memorized?
Jesus wept.
Shortest verse in the Bible. Time is most important in everything we do. wait. Because he wanted the people there to know who he was. Had he done it from 2 days away, people would have said, oh, he wasn't there today. Maybe he was just sleeping and resting. But when Jesus got there, there was a stone over the grave. And he had them remove it. He didn't remove it. He could have. God wants us to be involved. So he had them move the stone. Our biggest problem today is we don't let Jesus take control. I can do it. I can do it. I know how. No. Let Jesus take control. I have been in this church when every seat here has been filled. Where are all these people? You think they're rainy day Christians? Huh? I know the COVID had a lot to do with it. A lot of people have gotten lazy and they say, well, I can just sit at home and watch TV. So-and-so's on, so-and-so's preaching. God says, forsake not the assembling of yourselves together, your brothers and sisters in Christ. And it is good for us to come together. I'm not going to go into it, but we've talked about all several y'all since we've been here. Yes. Are you here today and you feel like your world's falling apart? Making mistakes, doing all the wrong things. Take it to Jesus. He'll resolve it. If conflict is making things worse, call on Jesus. He is not only gentle Jesus, meek and mild. He is strong, decisive, and has the almighty ability to handle any problem that we have. But, when you give the problem to him, your life should be given to him. Remember, you must give yourself. Like I said before, we talk to God, but we don't listen to God. There's an old saying I wrote down that says, if you keep doing what you've always done, you'll always get what you've always gotten. Does that make sense? If you keep doing what you've always done, you'll always get what you've always got. We need to meet our problems head on. Take them to Jesus. There's an old saying that there's always light at the end of the tunnel. Well, let me tell you, take Jesus with you and you got light all the way. Amen?
Amen.
Let's go back to where Jesus prayed to the Father out loud. He did this so that the people around the grave of Lazarus would who he was, that he was the Son of God. And I love this. Had he said, come forth, every dead person in that graveyard would have come out. But he didn't. He said, come forth. Let him. He could have said it the other way. He had a big congregation there, wouldn't he? Huh? But you know what? Think about this. Someday, we're going to hear that shout. And the dead in Christ shall rise first, and all of us, the left, will rise to meet him in the air. Hallelujah. What a day that will be. Glory to God. It is the most utmost importance to you and me that we are have absolute clarity about who Jesus is. You must be sure in your heart and your mind who Jesus is to you. Is he your Lord? Is he your Savior? He is far more than just an example of good luck. He's the Son of God who died for you and me. And he raised that. He loved you, and he went to the cross, had his hands nailed to a wooden cross and his feet, and a sword through his side. He took all of your sins and my sins, past, present, and future, upon himself. We go nuts if we cut our finger or rip a fingernail. Can you imagine him laying there, letting them drive nails through his hands and through his feet? Your Lord and Savior? Or did you just come to church because it's a good place to get out of the rain? Well, I came on to see Aunt Joe or Uncle Sam, talk to them a little bit about what's been going on last week. Or talk to somebody. Did you get me a Christmas present this year? Why are you here? Judas Iscariot and wear a mask of pretense. Make sure that you are saved by God's grace. Now at this time of year, we're looking to Christmas Day, right? Our Savior's birthday, by the way. Are we putting too much time on trees and lights and presents? Are we? How about time with Jesus? He's the reason for the season. Amen? It's the time that we should be thanking Him for His love for each of us. He took time to share His grace on each of us on the cross. But now it's our time to make the decision if and when we'll accept that wonderful gift of salvation. It's free. It's free. No credit card, no checks, no money. It's free, folks. And you know what? There is a present involved. Forever home in heaven with Jesus. No more sickness, heartaches, just singing and praising God all the time. You know, we get up in the morning and say, oh, my back is hurting, oh, my legs hurt, oh, I got a headache. No more of that. No more of that. And just think, guys and gals, when you get to heaven, you're going to be singing. You might not have a guitar or drums, but you can sing and praise God all the time. Now, it's time you decide really to take the time to give God your best. Stop being in a backslidden condition. It's your time to give God time. And if you're not sure if you're saved by God's grace, today's the day, folks. Time is wasting. Time is short. Look at the world today, what's happening. There are wars, there are rumors of wars. There are earthquakes, storms, all over the world. Come any moment. Wouldn't that be something? Get all this. Go up in there. I love to fly. I hate the water, but I love to fly. When I was in the Navy, people said, what ship was you on? Well, I wasn't on the ship. I was a Navy CB. And they put me on the C-130 and they'd fly me where they want my job done and fly me back. So I love to fly. I can just imagine when you come. Hallelujah. You feel that way? Are you smiling because you're hoping I'm about through? Or are you serious? You want to give God your best time. We all make mistakes. God knows that. This world is controlled by Satan. But we have Jesus. And He will give us the strength to fight Satan. But you got to be willing. You got to be willing. I guess that's my question this morning. Are you willing? And if you don't know if you're born again or not, come talk to me. I'll tell you about Jesus. God of grace and mercy, touch your people today. May your Holy Spirit have its way here today in your church, that your children will make the decision to join with you, either in work or salvation. I give you. And Lord, I ask that you touch Pastor Jerry and his wife Liz with your healing hand and bring them back to your people.
I Last Supper. It says that the Lord Jesus said that he took the bread. He said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you." In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." It says, as they left, Jesus and the disciples sang hymns. Jeff is going to lead us in "Blessed Be the Tithe of Bible."
Please join us. One verse of "Blessed Be the Tithe of Bible."
Blessed be the tithe that binds our hearts in Christian love and
Well, that's